concern. John said in one of our beginning verses, John 15:13, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Now, verse 13 is quoted with some frequency. I'm sure you've heard it before. But less frequently quoted is the verse that immediately precedes verse 13 and the verse following immediately after, which is verse 12 and verse 14. So let's put them up on the board. John 15:12 and 15:14. This is my commandment, that ye, the words agape here, folks, that you do what? Love one another as I have, same word, loved you. Not unlike Paul's statement in Romans 13:8, is it no man anything Paul said but to agape one another? Of course, John was writing to the nation Israel. And John 15:14 goes on to say, ye are my friends if ye do what? Whatsoever I command you. And what did he just commanded them? Agape one another. And greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Of course, Israel had the same sin nature problem, which is common to all men. The problem James highlighted in James chapter 4, verse 4. Notice what James has to state here to Israel. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Not a friend to God? Whosoever will be a friend of the world is what? The enemy of God. Study it out. And you'll find that the nation Israel proved over and over and over again that they were not friends of God. They were enemies of God because they were indeed friends of the world. Keep in mind, the Gentiles prior to the establishment of the nation Israel had already proven that they were friends of the world. They worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 1, verse 25. So they had been the enemy of God before God ever established his earthly people, his earthly nation. In Romans 1:28, Paul gives us a little further insight into the pre-Israel mindset of man. Let's take a quick look. Romans 1:28. And even as did God have foreknowledge of faith when he judged mankind? Listen to this. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Paul goes on to list some of those things, by the way, of which these folks were guilty. He says in Romans 1, verses 29 through 32, and I'll just read this to you. Being filled with all unrighteousness, listen to his list, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. They didn't wish to retain God in their knowledge, Paul said. You know, this gives us great insight into why atheism and evolutionism have such enormous appeal today. The reason lies not in the intellect of man, but in the will of man. Men don't wish to retain God in their knowledge. It isn't that the evidence is so overwhelming that God does not exist or that evolution is the answer to existence that makes men entertain such thoughts. It's that men simply want an explanation of origin that eliminates God altogether. They don't want to think about God. They don't want to keep him ever present in their minds. They do not wish to retain him in their knowledge. They don't have evidence to do away with him, but to be sure, they have a desire to do away with him. And a desire to not retain God in our knowledge is proven by much more than notions such as atheism and evolutionism. Do we ever do that which is unseemly? Are we guilty of any of those things in Paul's listing? Think back to the listing of the behaviors Paul included to prove that pre-Israel mankind did not wish to retain God in their knowledge. You see, the word translated knowledge is the Greek word epignosis, meaning experiential knowledge. They didn't want to entertain God or think about God in their daily experience. Paul would have us understand the same truth that John just told Israel. One cannot be said to love God in the agape sense. We're not talking about emotion here. When one cannot agape God and practice godless behavior at the same time. Paul's showing us here in Romans that such was the case with Israel. Tell me, has anything changed according to our apostle? Listen to the apostle in Romans chapter 3, verse 9. What then, are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before proved, both Jews and Gentiles, that they all are what? They are all under sin. And of course, following verse 9 comes that well-known verse 10. Romans 3:10, as it is written, there is, verb tense is present, indicative, active. None perfectly righteous is the idea here. No, not one. Who among us is not familiar with Romans 3:23? For all have sinned, and the word all being implied here, all are, even now is the verb tense, coming short of the glory of God. No, Christ had to go far beyond the greatest love that belongs to his human creation. If greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends, Christ had to go far beyond a willingness to die for his friends. He had to be willing to die for his enemies. How many of us, in a behavioral sense, can say we are the friends of God today? In a behavioral sense. How many of us always prefer others above self? Christ had to be willing to die, to do more than die for his friends. He had to be willing to die for his enemies. And Paul takes us there in Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 8 and following. Let's just read some of these. For when we were yet without strength, Paul says, in due time, or at the appointed time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely will a righteous man, for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans chapter 5, verse 9. Much more then, being now justified by his blood. Did you catch that? Being now justified by his blood, we shall be what? Saved from wrath through him. Now do you appreciate God's justness and the fact that he keeps his promises? He cannot lie. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Does this not bring to mind Paul's words in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5? But God, who is rich in mercy, notice it, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, he hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. Christ laid down his life not for his friends, but for his enemies, according to Paul. Now think about that for a moment. Mull that over in your minds.